Dithering is the process of intentionally adding noise to a signal during the process of quantization to preserve low-level information and prevent correlated distortion. That is a loaded statement. You don't have to fully understand this statement right away. In the rest of this video, we'll try to decipher it. But right off the bat, why would we want to intentionally add noise to a signal? As audio engineers, we strive to keep our recordings clean and noise-free. The concept of adding noise seems counterintuitive. Before we get into dithering our audio files, let's visually see what dithering can do for us. Here's a high-contrast grayscale image. Each pixel in this image is represented by one byte of information. That's 8 bits. So each pixel can store 255 different possible monochromatic values. From 0, which represents black, to 255, which represents white, and all the different luminance values in between. We can say that this is an 8-bit grayscale image. Now let's do something drastic. Let's drop the bit depth of this image to 1. If we truncate the sample resolution to just 1 bit, each pixel can only represent 2 values, black or white, and so the resultant image is a true black and white image, where the pixels that were previously less than 50% bright are rounded to black, and the rest of them are rounded to white. We lose a lot of detail when we do this. Let's see how we can try and preserve some of the information when we step down the resolution. This is the same image, but with a little bit of noise added to it. A random value between 0 and 50% of the full scale is added to or subtracted from each pixel in this image. Now when we try to truncate the resolution down to 1 bit, we get this. This is considerably more detailed than the 1 bit image that was generated when the original was not dithered. If you look at this image more closely, you can see that there are still only 2 possible values, but the density distribution of the black pixels is different at different parts of the image, and this gives you the perception of information being preserved. This was, like most things, an exaggerated example. And things don't exactly translate the same between image processing and audio processing, but we can infer a couple of points from this image dithering example. Noise only needs to be applied if you're reducing the resolution of the source. In other terms, noise only needs to be applied if you're truncating the word length or lowering the bit depth. All the same, really, it's just different vocabulary to express it. Let's look at an example. Here we have a piano chord sustained. In the DAW software, the samples of this audio file exist as 32-bit floating point numbers. When any processing is done in the digital domain, the operations and calculations occur with 32 bits of high precision. But at some point of time, this audio file needs to be played back on the monitors, or written to the disk, or to a CD, or streamed online. At that point of time, the resolution needs to be dropped, and the floating point numbers would need to be converted to integers for the digital to analog converters to recognize them. And you'd need to drop the bit depth to either 24 bits, which is possibly the highest resolution at which modern DACs could faithfully reproduce audio, or even further down to 16 bits, where most of the consumer audio files are saved at. Let's simulate this. Let's say we've finished our mix and we want to hear it and save it. Let's go a step down and produce it at 8 bits of resolution instead. I'm going to make use of the Ozone 8 mastering plugin from Isotope. It makes sense that a dither processor is on a mastering plugin. That's because mastering is the final step of audio production, and you'd only want to step down the resolution of the audio file at the final step, and nowhere in between. An exception to this is if you have external effect sends to analog devices like reverb units. Any place where audio leaves the digital domain and enters the analog domain is where truncation happens. It's unavoidable. All right, so dithering is currently turned off and we're expecting the audio to be truncated to 8 bits when we listen to it. Let's listen to it. Did you hear the digital tear and then silence? Again? In the beginning, the noise that you hear is 8-bit quantization noise. If you've been following the previous video in the series about bit depth and quantization, this shouldn't be a surprise to you. The quantization noise is almost like broadband white noise. But towards the end, when the audio is fading to silence, we get this tearing noise that is incredibly distracting. Why does this happen? Let's look at this interactive widget created by Nigel Redman. Link in the description. The signal in blue is our high-resolution digital signal. Now, when we want to step down the resolution, we round the signal or quantize the signal to the nearest discrete amplitude level, depending on the bit depth we choose. If I reduce the amplitude level of the signal, though, you can see that the number of levels available for quantization reduces as well. The bit depth remains the same, and so does the quantization error, but the level of this signal relative to the error is getting smaller and smaller, meaning that the signal to quantization error ratio is getting low as well. At around half a quantization level, or half of the least significant bit, we are at the fringe of what is quantizable. And if the signal dips below that, the quantized signal is rounded to zero, and all detail is lost. Any amount of amplitude modulation when the signal is fading out could lead to the quantization signal jumping in and out of silence. This causes the unmistakable tearing sound that you hear in poorly quantized or undithered masters. Let's see what dither can do for us. We're in Reaper. I'm going to choose to turn on dithering when outputting at 8 bits. We can hear that the tearing noise is gone and is just replaced by constant noise. Is this better? You've got to remember that most digital recordings are saved at a bit depth of 16 bits or higher, which means the noise associated with a 16-bit audio track is about 48 decibels lower than this, and almost inaudible. Noise, especially white noise, is remarkably undistracting to our hearing perception. The brain usually tunes out a little bit of white noise in a mix. On the other hand, sudden jumps and cuts, even in low-level noise, can immediately be noticed and turns our attention towards it. This is what we are trying to avoid by using dither. But how does adding noise actually solve the problem? We turn back to the widget. If I turn on dithering, you can see a series of red points spread across the board. What dithering does is add a random value to each of the original sample values. The range of the random value depends on system to system, but in this case, and generally in most cases, the range is 2 least significant bits. A maximum of 1 LSB can be added to the original sample, and a minimum of 1 LSB can be subtracted from the original signal. The reason why I mention LSB or least significant bit here and not some concrete value is that the range is dependent on the target bit depth. For instance, the random value range for a target bit depth of 8 is much larger than the randomness required for a target bit depth of 16. Let's connect the dots to visualize the plot better. Now that we have a signal with a randomized noise or dither added to it, when the resolution is lowered, the signal is rounded to the nearest discrete level. You can see that when the signal level is lowered below the quantizable level, where the original signal would have been rounded to zero, the noise within the signal allows the dithered signal to be rounded up from time to time, thereby keeping the noise floor constant. What you get with dither is a constant and predictable noise floor, rather than the instantaneous dropout of the signal from noise to silence. This isn't the only problem dither solves. Let's bring back the definition. So we understand why we intentionally add noise, and we understand that doing this can preserve the noise floor of the signal when the signal dips below it. The other important reason why dither is added to signals is to prevent correlated distortion. This is possibly the biggest advantage of dither. When we quantize a track, we're now accustomed to the fact that quantization results in error. And this error manifests itself as noise. We never gave too much thought to the type of noise it results in and just assumed that it would be broadband noise. And most of the time, it is. If the audio being quantized is rich and loud, the resultant error signal is absolutely random and follows no discernible pattern and is said to be uncorrelated with the original audio. This is what results in noise which is white, the randomness, and this is what we strive for. But things are different when the source material is really low in amplitude or when the source signal is simple in nature and not rich or complex. Under these circumstances, the error from the quantization is more predictable, tends to follow along with the underlying signal, and has a tendency of forming patterns and repeating itself. The error isn't random anymore, it's correlated. And the error doesn't result in noise anymore, it results in sonic distortions, and sometimes these distortion partials stick out like a sore thumb, well above the noise floor, and can get very noticeable and distracting. Let me show you what I mean. Here's a sine wave oscillator playing a few notes. This is as simple a signal as it can get, and this is what it sounds like at a high bit depth. When we lower the bit depth, we expect to hear some quantization error. Let's listen to what it sounds like. Right. Now, that doesn't sound like broadband noise. What it does sound like is a square wave or a sawtooth wave being played alongside our signal, and these additional partials quite clearly being out of tune. If we examine the output spectrum, we can see distinct partials sticking out above the expected noise floor of about negative 48 decibels, and these partials clearly influencing our output signal. If we add dither, however, we notice that the partials are gone, and we get a clear output signal with no distortion components, just added broadband noise. If we notice the spectrum of the undithered and dithered signals side by side, we can see that we've compromised the signal with a slightly higher noise floor to get rid of the distortion partials. Again, as a reminder, the noise here is significant since the signal has been truncated to 8 bits. But at 16 bits, the noise is barely audible. And at 24 bits, the noise is completely inaudible. It's easy to see why distortion partials appear. When quantizing a simple signal, the rounding errors are predictable. Here, the quantized output signal is just a more complex form of the sine wave. And as the signal dips, we see a clear pulse wave being formed. And pulse waves have enormous amounts of harmonic content. If you introduce dither, the correlation is gone. And so are the strong partials that can be formed. The rounding errors are randomized. Let's bring back the definition again one last time. By now you should have a fairly good understanding of what dither does and why it's needed. There's one last thing that I want to add, and that's where and when dither is needed. As I've mentioned before, dither can be applied wherever truncation happens. This is usually at the last step of production when the track is bounced, but this could also be within plugins which operate at a high bit depth when compared to the hosting program. As to when it's needed when audio is re-quantized at 16 bits or lower. That means when you're converting 32-bit audio to 16-bit audio, 24-bit to 16, or even 16-bit to 16, there's definite possibility of correlated distortion within a 16-bit quantized track being heard. So always dither when you're targeting 16-bit output. If you're targeting audio output at 24 bits, then don't dither. Even when it's truncation from 32 bits to 24 bits. Yes, correlated distortion would still occur in this scenario, but the partial strength and the noise floor would be well below the threshold of hearing for 24-bit audio, and so it's never heard. You can dither if you want to. There is no downside to it. But there's no upside either. The effects just won't be heard. In the next video, we'll take a look at the different types of dither and different probability density functions for applying noise. This would be an implementation level topic targeted towards programmers. So if you think you've heard enough about dither, feel free to skip the next one. But do catch me on the one after, where I'll be talking about noise shaping, a super interesting concept that's applied alongside dithering to change the shape of the overall noise floor of the quantized signal and to make 16-bit tracks usable and effective in the real world without needing to go any higher in bit depth. Take it easy.